This is Ham Radio Now, episode number, yet to be determined, somewhere in the late 180s to 190s. And the title is, what do I want to title this? I know what I want to title this, I'm just not sure I want to title it that. Okay, CQ comes clean. Sorry, Rich. So we've all known the CQ magazine has had some trouble in the past, several years, but, last year and this year, particularly, some big changes in what is in the magazine and struggling financially. So this is at the Orlando Hamcation. This is the exhibitor building inside. Rich Moseson did show up this year from CQ magazine, the editor, W2VU, and I had... Well, I thought it was going to be a short conversation with him. Turned out to be a long conversation, so I'm making it an entire episode, and we will find out what's really going on at CQ. I've gotten a fair amount of email. There's been lots of comments in various places on QRZ, on Facebook, online. CQ's got a lot of folks that are pulling for him, but they're really wondering what's going on. So I tried to pull all that information out of Rich. He can only be so forthcoming. It is a company, and they have obligation to... certain amount of privacy, but he told me pretty much what's really happening there. And let's go in and talk to him. You're checking out the technology.
Of course, I'm a ham.
And I've given you your own microphone, so no one accused me of pulling the mic away at the critical point when you want to make your own point.
Okay,
Rich, it's just you and me here. Nobody's watching.
Oh, good.
And given my average audience, that's a pretty accurate statement. Let's review.
It's also accurate for a Sunday morning at a typical ham fest.
Yeah, there's people here, but it's not real busy. This is better than most Sunday ham
fests. Yes, most definitely. Yeah. There are people here.
Yeah. So let's review a little bit.
Okay.
But last time I talked to you was Dayton last year, and you were hopeful you had merged the... you're closing down the... Popular Communications and CQVHF and World Radio Online, merging them into CQ in the digital version of CQ Plus. Mm-hmm. And you had gone through with the having to combine I think it was February, March issue at that time and trying to catch up. And so we've been almost a year since then, and things have not gone as well as you wanted.
True.
Give me a review. What's this past year been like?
It's been a very challenging year. It's a tough time to be in the publishing business. It's nothing of what's going on with us is unique to us. It's an experience that's being shared by publishers of magazines all over the place. And so it's a very tough time to be in the magazine publishing industry. Print is having its difficulties, but digital really isn't catching fire to compensate for it, both in terms of people wanting to read magazines on their digital devices or in terms of advertisers wanting to be advertising in a digital-only format.
And my impression is that ham radio is I don't know, maybe a decade or so behind the curve of general media in terms of where things stand for magazines. General media magazines have been dying for a long time, but ham radio is still focused more on their magazines as media than anything else.
Well,
that hasn't helped.
Our audience is still heavily focused on print media.
Yeah.
And we have to serve the audience.
But I guess the easy way to say it is they haven't been buying CQ fast enough. In large enough numbers.
Well, obviously, we'd always like to have more people.
Yeah.
But a magazine's real revenue is from advertising. And that market has been soft because, I don't know about you, but we seem to have missed a few of the memos about the economic recovery.
Yes, sir.
And so have a lot of our advertisers. It's still a very difficult economy out there unless you're a banker or a stockbroker.
So it's not so much subscribers as advertising revenue.
Our subscribers are incredibly loyal and supportive. I mean, this here at the show, this is one of the reasons I love to come to shows, is because I get to talk with our readers one-on-one. And, you know, in a sense, it's gratifying that some of them are so upset because we've been late with the delivery, because what it's saying is that they really want their magazine.
Yeah.
They love the magazine. They really want it. And if they didn't look forward to it so much, they wouldn't care so much about it. And the overwhelming message that I've gotten from our readers is extremely supportive. We have the most wonderful readers in the world.
But it sounds like it doesn't matter if you are to get a whole bunch more of them, and not that you wouldn't want to get a whole bunch more of them, but that wouldn't help much.
Certainly that would help, but the bulk of any magazine's revenue is from advertising. You know, except for, okay, if you're a Make magazine and you have a cover price of $15, or, you know, and a subscription price for four issues of like $50 and very little advertising, that's a different calculation.
There are a few magazines out there that don't do advertising, like Consumer Reports and stuff,
right.
But they're a unique case.
And they have a much higher subscription rate because of it. But in the basic consumer magazine model, the bulk of the revenue comes from advertising.
So the lack of advertising, do you think that reflects the economic state of the amateur radio industry, the manufacturers and
I think it reflects
retailers?
The overall economic state of the economy. We are all, you know, we're an industry primarily of small businesses, and small businesses continue to struggle. And it's tough. And we are doing everything we can to try to get back on track. And
your advertisers,
some months
and your advertisers and your potential advertisers want to see you succeed. They want to see themselves succeed. They're not just sitting on a pile of money saying, nah, I don't think I'll advertise.
They're not sitting on a pile of money, exactly. And that's part of a big part of the problem, is that they have limited resources and they have to figure out how they're allocating those resources. And hopefully we're a part of that picture. But until the economy really does improve for the average person to the point where their resources are greater, then we're going to be suffering along with them.
Does this become sort of a self-eating watermelon? I mean, it's a downward spiral between they can't support you and you can't pitch them, and then they can't support you and you can't pitch them?
Well, hopefully not.
Of course, we can hopefully
spit out the seeds. We are, you know, this close to getting ourselves back on schedule, and we do encounter a new obstacle every now and then that throws us back a step, but we are getting inching closer as we go here.
Okay, so let's complete the little review.
Okay.
This year, you have another double issue. It's January, February,
right.
And that becomes the last issue that has the CQ Plus stuff incorporated.
Right.
So now, and it's, by the way, your 70th anniversary issue.
Yes,
so
it is.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
and it's, you know, it's bittersweet, I'm sure, to be at that point, that much heritage, that much history, and to say, and now we have to axe a bunch more stuff from the magazine. The CQ Plus stuff is gone, at least for now.
CQ Plus was an experiment to try to continue to serve those segments of our audience who were served by Popular Communications, World Radio Online, and CQ VHF in some sort of a tangible way. And unfortunately, that turned out not to be economically viable. And this goes back to the question of digital advertising. And it seems that the people who buy advertising, and not just us, not just this market, but overall, are not ready to seriously support digital-only publications. I mean, you look at Newsweek as the prime example. They stopped their print publication, went digital only, and found that they couldn't survive digital only, and they had to go back to doing a print edition as well in order to get the advertising revenue that they needed to succeed.
Yeah, I'm not sure they're still succeeding, but they're at least
trying. Surviving.
Yeah, maybe.
But from an economic perspective, digital only is not ready for prime time.
Well, you're preceding one of the questions I was going to ask is, would it be possible for CQ to become digital only? And it sounds like the answer to that is a clear no right now.
It would be possible, but it's certainly not anything that we want to do. Because
and by possible, physically possible, of course.
Yeah.
Economically possible.
It's not something that we are aiming toward. A lot of people say to us, oh, you just are trying to get us to all go digital. and no, we're not. A large majority of our readers prefer print. We have a very healthy number who like the digital ones as well. Probably about a third of our total circulation is on the digital side.
Mm-hmm.
But we have the two-thirds who are on print and want to stay there. And we want to continue to serve them in print. And that's where the real revenue that keeps us going is.
Yeah. In terms of your costs, as you leave print, or as print is goes out of the equation, how much does that really save you? How much is the printing, the physical printing of the magazine and the postage after the magazine's been all made up and ready to go as a digital magazine? Because you've been on time for publishing the magazine for mm-hmm. the folks that are digital.
Yes,
it's usually you do something different than what most magazines do. Most magazines put the cover month somewhere between 15 days and 6 months ahead of the actual cover. but you print the magazine about 10, 15 days into the actual month of the cover.
Well, we would like to be able to get the print magazine out in people's hands by the beginning of the month of the cover month. And that's what we're doing with the digital edition.
Yeah, so
we
want to keep them in the first 10 days of the month or so.
The digital edition, we're focus on the first of the month, basically, for having that online. It varies a few days here and there, depending on the calendar and other little factors. But basically, that has been consistently on time.
Yep. Which means the magazine is pretty much done.
Yeah. Obviously, printing and postage are significant cost issues. There are significant costs of doing a digital magazine as well. People think it's free. It's not.
Anything on the internet is free.
And they think it should be free for them, and it can't be.
But how much, what is the percentage, the ballpark percentage of printing and postage? If a magazine shovels that away, like Newsweek did, like a lot of others have done, what are they saving?
I really can't give you numbers on that. I don't know them. My primary job is to generate the material that goes into it, and we have other people in the organization who are responsible for taking care of the printing and the postage and the contracts and costs involved in that. Not part of what I'm involved in on a daily basis.
So I guess we can say it's not half?
I don't know.
Okay, absolutely not.
I do not know at all.
All right.
So.
In your editorial meetings and the business meetings, have you discussed going all digital at some point?
This topic has come up from time to time for years now. And our experience has been that the market is not ready for it. And it's not really something that we would want to do. But even if we felt we were forced to do it, we would be very skeptical about the ability to make it work. When we started publishing World Radio Online back in 2009, our goal at that time was to have it be totally advertiser-supported and free to readers. The advertising wasn't there for it. It couldn't support it, even at, the cost of advertising was very low, and we couldn't generate even the revenue that was needed for that.
Yeah. Was it supporting itself as a print publication?
It was supporting itself as a print publication when Armand Noble was publishing it, but only
on
because...
On a shoestring.
Yes. It was on a shoestring, and he published three or four different magazines in different markets, all using that newsprint for printing on. And as a result of that, he was able to work with printers on economies of scale. So his cost for the newsprint for the four magazines made it doable for him. When you pull out any one of those, your costs go up dramatically because you didn't have that scale.
So it was more expensive for you to do the
printout. It was not affordable from the beginning for us to continue publishing that in print on even on newsprint.
Yeah.
But it went to, you know, the advertising marketplace wasn't there for it in digital form. And when we decided that we needed to go back to a subscription model on it in order to keep going with it, we put the princely sum of $10 for a subscription to start with. And very few people were willing to part with that. It's a matter of perceived value.
Yeah.
They were getting it for free, and that's what it's worth. That's one of the fallacies in talking about digital publications. Oh, they should be so cheap because you don't have print and postage costs. Well, that's true, but you do have other costs. But what you're dealing with, really, what when you buy a magazine, you're not saying, oh, this is wonderful paper. I really want to buy this because of the quality of this paper. You're buying it for the words and pictures that are on the paper. You're buying it for the content. And the value of that content doesn't change because of the medium in which it's presented. And that's what we're selling. We're not out there selling ink and paper. We're selling content. And the value of that content has to be maintained, and the costs of generating that content do not change.
And people might not know what those costs of generating it are for a magazine like CQ. How big is your staff? How big is your full-time staff?
Full-time staff is pretty small at the moment. We've scaled back to pretty tight levels to try to keep
things up. But every one
up.
Of those is supporting
but
a
there,
household.
There are, there are salaries, there are mortgages, there's rent to be paid on the office, there's utilities.
They have that nasty habit of eating every day.
Right.
Or in the case
taxes,
of your staff,
medical
probably
insurance,
once or twice a week.
All of these things are out there that have to be paid.
And you have,
and we
not
have writers.
Full-time staff. You've got writers and the people that... I guess everybody who does the makeup of the magazine, the physical layout and all that stuff.
You know, we
physical,
have our art department.
Yeah.
And what they do for print versus digital is the same. So they still the same amount of work that goes into it, the same amount of hours that go into it.
And maybe even a little bit more, because now you're putting in links and,
right.
and connecting things to the magazine that never got connected in a print magazine. And if you think that that is... not actually any work. I've done that, and there's a lot of work to make sure all that stuff is working right.
Mm-hmm. I just want to talk a little bit about going forward with the with CQ Plus. While we have eliminating the additional 50-60 pages a month in the digital edition that did not appear in the print edition, we're doing our best to try to incorporate some content from there into CQ. Seven of the columns that appeared on a regular basis in CQ Plus will be rolled over into the mix of the columns in CQ. For the shortwave listeners among us, which there are many among our readers, Jerry Dexter's Listening Post column with loggings of different shortwave stations will be there every month. And several of the other columns, which appeared either bimonthly or quarterly, will be in on a similar rotating basis in the pages of CQ.
Is CQ physically going to get a few pages bigger, or is that
not
just
at the moment.
Displacing
it's just
something?
Squeezing out, trying to maybe get people to write a little tighter, or perhaps.
Don't ask me to try to do that.
One less feature in a given month or something like that.
Not contest results.
It's a balancing act that we do every month. And
yeah, because you think of the digital version as unlimited, and it's still not, because it's still work to make up every one of those pages. So at some point, they've got to publish it, so you got to be done. So articles will, some favorite things will still be there.
Yes, and while CQ will continue to have its primary focus on amateur radio, as it has for the past 70 years, if somebody has a really good article about another aspect of the broader radio hobby, of, you know, a good shortwave story, a good broadcast history story, the things that we used to cover in popular communications, or, you know, we've already started integrating stuff about that used to be in the pages of CQVHF. We've had, you know, moon bounce articles and things like that. Anything that's about the broader radio hobby that is a good, well-told story, I will be happy to consider for part of the article mix that goes into the magazine.
All right. There are some things that people have emailed me to ask.
Okay.
You know, some delicate or at least more difficult things to talk about. When you've got the magazine pretty much done on time, and yet the physical magazine doesn't show up for weeks or maybe even months, most of us adding the 2+2 are going to say you couldn't play for the printing or you couldn't pay for the postage or both. Is that fairly accurate?
It's I'm not going to lie to people. It's very tight. It's very, very tough. It's a difficult environment. And it's a constant balancing act. And in some cases, things get compounded. For example, with the January issue, which was horrendously late going out to begin with, the post office proceeded to sit on it for 2 weeks before starting to deliver it to people.
Was it January or December?
I'm sorry, it's December. Yeah. And
January sitting right over there.
January sitting right here. And
that's probably in your mailboxes when you watch this at the earliest point.
And, you know, when the post office pulls something like that on us, that's something we have no control over at all. And we go to the post office, they say, oh, there's no problem, it went right out.
Well, nobody got it.
Yeah.
We're the post office, we don't care.
And the post office, interestingly,
a lot of post office people mad at me.
Interestingly, the post office is more likely to listen to complaints from the end recipient, from the consumer, than from mailers, even though the mailers are the ones who are physically paying them to ship the material.
Yeah, and maybe
the
they would complain,
the better ear.
Yeah, right now they're just saying, well, they just haven't published this CQ, so I'm not going to blame the post office yet. So maybe get that word out better. We sent it. Everybody call your post office.
And, you know, we definitely were late with sending it, but the post office then sat on it. My only guess in that regard is that it got, you know, stuck in the pallets of magazines, got stuck off in a corner of the sectional center someplace and forgotten about for 2 weeks until somebody came across them and said, what are these doing here? Aren't we supposed to be delivering these?
Yep. Back in better days, did that happen very often?
It did happen from time to time, yes. I wouldn't say very often, but, you know, once every 2 or 3 years, yes.
Okay.
Things would just disappear into the post office and be weeks before they came out.
The other tricky or difficult question is communicating with CQ. Probably, well, not necessarily even disgruntled subscribers, but people who are just wondering what's happening. What's happening with my subscription? Where's the magazine? I get people who say they write, they get no responses, writing by email typically, don't get a response, they call, they get shuffled around but never get an answer. Is it difficult for people to, you don't have a lot of staff to answer a lot of mail.
Right, we have a limited staff at the moment, but there's also, we've been trying to figure this out because our customer service manager, who works very, very hard, has told me over and over that she responds to every email she gets and every phone message she gets, and yet a lot of people say they're not getting responses. So there's either messages are not getting to us, or our responses are not getting delivered to them. And we don't know what the situation is there and where the problem is. We know there's a problem, and we're working on trying to identify it. I have no reason not to believe my colleague, who I've worked with for years and years, and I when I'm in the office, I sit across the hall from her, and I hear her on the phone, and she is probably the hardest working person in the whole place, among a whole group of very hard working people. And I have no reason to doubt her when she tells me that she deals with everything that comes in. There is a bottleneck someplace, and we're trying to figure out where it is, but we haven't figured it out yet. We're either not getting messages that are being sent, they're being ending up in spam filter someplace, or responses are ending up in spam filter someplace. Yeah.
Do you have a suggestion for people trying to communicate with you and feeling like they're not being answered? You're saying, we will answer you. We want to answer you.
Yes.
If you're not getting an answer, it's not because we don't want to answer you.
Right.
We're not hiding. We're not ducking.
I would say keep trying.
If email doesn't work, phone call?
Yeah. And, we will do our best to get back to you and get the information to you that you're looking for.
Yep. The subscription renewal forms that we all get 40, 50 times a year, they're kind of automated. If I've got 3 years left on my subscription and I get a subscription renewal form in the fall blowout or whatever the promotion is, that's going to come anyway, right? That's not tied to how long I've got left on my subscription.
There are two different things that we will send out. One is a standard renewal, which we start sending out when you have 3 months left on your subscription. It's not like other magazines. I know Time Magazine starts sending me your subscription is expiring messages 9 months before it expires. I've basically sent them the check for the current issue, and they tell me for the current year, and they tell me it's expiring and I need to renew. We don't do that. 3 months out, we start our regular renewal cycle. We also do promotional early renewal efforts, such as the Spring Fever, which is not tied to your expiration date. It's giving you the regular renewals go out at the regular subscription rate. The promotions, such as Spring Fever, go out at a discount. So we're offering you a break on your subscription if you renew early. And that's the purpose of those.
Okay, so watch those. Most of us consumers, from a consumer point of view, is we look at that thing, we don't look very hard at it. And we probably don't get any nuance of the message. And I know this is not a very nuanced message. It's spring fever, save money.
Right.
But most of us go, yeah, okay, chuck it. I've got 4 years to go and they're asking me to renew. What the heck? So, consumer feedback.
Basically, if you get a subscription mailing from us and it's offering a discount, it's not tied to your expiration date. Okay. It's tied to, we wanted running a promotion, want to give you the opportunity to save some money on extending your subscription.
Promotion.
If it's at full price and it says your subscription is expiring, our promotions do not say your subscription is expiring. If it says your subscription is about to expire and it's at the full price, then your subscription is about to expire. But if it doesn't say that and if there's a discount on it, it's just part of a promotion to save you some money on extending your subscription.
Promotion rates don't seem to be available online.
I'm not keyed into the details of that, but I believe you're correct. I think that it's tied to that mailing and that you have to respond to that mailing.
Yeah. Okay. Other publications, I'm going to circle
back. It doesn't
back
mean that we don't occasionally do online promotions.
Okay. Just have to watch for what's
right.
What's
that are specific to the online store.
Yeah. And speaking of the subscriptions and
and prices, although it doesn't necessarily reflect the actual costs, a digital-only subscription is only a few dollars less than a print subscription.
It's $12 less than the
print subscription. I thought it was like, you know, maybe five.
No, our regular subscription price is $38.95, or, you know, call it $39. Our digital price is $27.
Okay.
So
that, I apologize, that is substantial, and it probably reflects...
It reflects the difference in our costs.
Yeah.
But the $27 reflects the core value of the material.
Yeah.
As well as the costs involved in producing and distributing the digital edition.
Yeah. And so you probably get complaints from people who say, I have to pay more for my print magazine. Well, yeah, it's because you're getting something in your hand. Costs more to do. In terms of other ham radio-related media that has gone all digital, just about every club newsletter in the country has gone some form of digital. And the club I'm in did it over a decade ago. And there were minor complaints from members, but it was just literally eating the club's treasury alive. QCWA, which is not as big as CQ, but a substantial organization, also bit the digital bullet. They eliminated their quarterly print publication and went to a monthly digital. And they're the old timers. You know, they're our old farts. Which, you know, I'm just past 50 years, so I qualify as an old fart. So I can have license to say that. But if those guys can handle it, it seems like the level of ham that we say, well, you know, the old guys, we're an aging demographic, and they're not that digital savvy. It seems like QCWA's experience, anyway, is saying maybe we are.
Well, you know, I'll never say never, but you have to keep in mind that the goals and purposes of those organizations are different. They are not-for-profit membership associations. No one's livelihood depends on it. No one's salary, mortgage, health insurance, etc., depends on whether your club newsletter can turn a profit.
Yeah, the stakes are lower.
And I
don't want to sound like I'm advocating it. What I want to sound like is I'm exploring the landscape.
We're always exploring the landscape, too. So far, what we're seeing in our explorations is that the market is not ready for it. And we will continue to explore the landscape, but we will also not cut off our noses despite our faces, just to be, you know, on the leading edge.
Yeah.
On the leading edge of falling off a cliff.
If you could predict the future with certainty, you'd know just what to do, and we can't.
Right.
You probably consulted psychics and Farmer's
and
Almanac and stuff.
Yeah.
That's just the ham radio population in general. So we're done with that part. Editorial content stuff. CQ continues to have fabulous content.
Well, thank you.
You said as an unsolicited testimonial. I mean, you're still finding stuff. You're still, you know, people are pouring their content in.
Yes. People have stories to tell, projects to share, ideas to have discussed, and there's a limited number of outlets for that these days. And we're happy that we're able to be a primary one. Not everything that people want to write about fits into the mission and format of the other magazine, which is primarily a membership journal.
I'm trying to remember which one you might be referring to. It's QTH.
It uses three letters instead of two in its title, but I don't remember what they are.
Go ahead. Look at that camera and say, hello, ARRL. I know it's QST.
Hello, ARRL. I know it's, what was that again? QRX?
We got something like that.
Something like
that,
yes.
This is a tough sell.
Our writers are wonderful. We love to have a mix of articles on activities, projects, etc. Our focus always has been on the practical aspects of ham radio and on the hobby side of things. If we're doing a project article, we want to make sure that it's something that is going to be of interest to a large number of our readers and on a level that a large number of our readers will be able to do. We're not an engineering journal, so we're not going to be doing really high-level stuff that requires you to be a PhD in electrical engineering to figure out or to have access to very specialized laboratory equipment in order to do.
And you don't have a lab, so your equipment reviews are purely amateur experience.
Yes, but it's in part intentional because we want to do the experiential part of it when we're looking at that other organization does have a lab, and why duplicate it? They do a very good job with their technical measurements, and what our focus on, again, is the practical. Well, what's it like to use this piece of equipment?
Yeah. Well, they do that, too, because I write reviews for QST, and I'm not an engineer, so they still have me write reviews, and it's clearly on the ham experience version. But if somebody were to read a review in QST and a review of the same piece of equipment in CQ, they're going to have a broader depth of knowledge of that piece of equipment than if they just read
because
one or the other.
Because there will be different perspectives from which they're being looked at.
Yeah, and some different things that editorially get included, because I know I include 50% more stuff than they have room to print. Same with you, but you're going to choose a little bit different mix of what goes into the magazine. All right, so it's 70 years as of the January issue. You were there for the first one.
Oh, yeah. Actually, I was noted a long time ago that I am the first editor of the magazine who is younger than the magazine.
Whoa. Well, you started when it was, you've been there, what, how many?
I'm going to turn 60 this year. So I was born 10 years after the magazine started.
Okay. And how long have you been editor now?
15 years.
Time flies.
Yeah.
Was your hair gray when you started?
Not as gray.
I don't think it was when I met you when we were doing the CQ videos.
That's
when
right.
You came down to Raleigh. And
long time ago now.
We first
23
met.
Years ago.
1992, I think. Helped me win the McGann Silver Antenna Award. Thanks very much. We had a lot of fun. That was back when television was a three-man crew.
That's right.
I have a zero-man crew. There's nobody standing behind these cameras here. So this is literally the one-man band. And you're still selling those DVDs. Every once in a while, I watch my wife, Cindy, KD4ACW, with the antenna that grows out of her head in animation and gets bit by the DX bug.
That's right.
And we have a great time watching those.
Still pop up every now and then, and we're still selling them. Yeah, because
you've copied the VHSs over to DVD.
Yep. The basics of DXing and the basics of contesting don't really change.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend buying the packet one anymore.
Yeah, well.
But it's a great historical perspective, and we don't want to lose. It's like, I love reading old QSTs. They're available to any ARL member. Just browse the ancient stuff, and the ads are the fun part, but also like some of the articles. And, that historical perspective you never want to lose. So it's good to see the way we did it. You can't steep yourself in it anymore, at least most of us can't, but it's kind of fun to do. All right, well, congratulations on 70 years. I'm hoping for CQ and for ham radio, 70 more. We all don't know what's going to happen. You want to make a ham radio prediction, five-year term?
Our challenge is to find better ways to engage the licensees who have not yet made themselves into active hams. Now, there's any number of ways to define what constitutes an active ham. I've written editorials about it, and we've probably discussed it before.
But so you're talking about people who got a ham license but never actually got on the air.
But don't do anything with it. We've got to get them not only on
the air.
Is that
a big thing?
I think it is, because we're not seeing, we're seeing growth in numbers of licensees. Good growth. Record numbers.
The repeaters are empty, and HF is actually not all that busy, even considering
well,
this.
Well, during our contest it is.
Yes, of course. But
and we're not seeing that much growth in clubs. We're not seeing that much growth in league membership. We're not seeing that much growth in our readership. The numbers that reflect activity in the ham community are not growing at the same rate that the number of licensees are growing. And I think our challenge as a community is to reach out and engage those newer licensees and get them active in the community.
Is that observation purely anecdotal, or are there some hard statistics that can back it up? It's one of those, everybody tells us things.
It's primarily anecdotal, but it's reflected in relative stability of numbers.
Okay.
Of league membership, our readership, club memberships.
And what you hear on the air. So yeah,
what you hear on the air.
So it's observational, maybe not just anecdotal. It's kind of obvious.
That there should be, if all of these newer licensees are becoming engaged in the community, in whatever aspect of the hobby that they want to, then we would be seeing greater growth in all of these areas.
So what could we do to get them on the air? Why aren't they, and what might they be doing that they're not thinking of that would put them someplace doing something?
If I knew that with certainty, I would be much more actively pursuing it.
Okay, so we're looking for that answer.
We are looking for that answer. It's something that we as a community need to brainstorm about and come up with ideas. I think social media is a very important element of that tool. There are a lot of people who are active on social media, who have ham licenses, who are kind of at the periphery, and we need to go to them and engage them and pull them in and get them to be part of the community.
So
and that's one part of it. There are other elements as well.
The two sides of that coin that I'm looking at are either get them to do the things that we already have for them to do, but maybe they're not thinking about it or not motivated enough to do it, but we all think they're fun. Or ham radio is not what they thought it was when they got in. And we need things to add things to ham radio that we don't have right now, that will engage these people and still be ham radio.
That's what we've been doing for 100 years. Okay, if we hadn't been doing that for 100 years, we'd all be sitting in front of our Spark transmitters.
We kind of are sitting in front of our sideband and CW transmitters.
But one of the things I'm seeing around here is that DMR is catching on very much all of a sudden. Digital voice in general. I mean, ICOM's had D-Star out for quite a long time, and it has an established user base. Last year, Yaesu introduced System Fusion. DMR is based on the Motorola platform. There are a couple of radios out there now that do multi-digital modes.
Well, they're coming. They're not really fully fledged yet.
But that's coming.
For voice.
So there is always new stuff coming into the hobby that will engage new people. We have to make sure that as this happens, the word gets out to people who may not be finding something that's grabbing them right now, and let them know that this is something you can do with ham radio.
Yeah, but there's still maybe things that we really need to invent that that haven't surfaced yet. And maybe new people need to do the inventing.
I'm sure there will be, yes.
Yeah, maybe some of the young new guys need to make those connections, which is kind of the way those changes happened that you're talking about,
mm-hmm.
that we kept evolving. It wasn't old stodgy hams that invented them.
I mean, look at Packet in the 1970s and 80s. It was new, young hams with this new stuff of computers and trying to network computers who invented packet radio and basically have paved the way for so much of our internet infrastructure. We need to have new people doing new stuff, because nobody in the 1960s would have even conceived of the idea of computers in a ham shack, connecting computers over the air, using them to send messages, using them to send pictures, files. And things also have a habit of lying latent for a long time and then suddenly coming into popularity because of new connections that can be made with them. For example, APRS. APRS is not a new technology. It's been around since the late 80s. And it had this base use group who enjoyed it, and it was very small. And now, suddenly, you're seeing it popping up more and more in different uses because of greater connectivity, putting the stuff together over the internet, and smaller transceivers or transmitters, if you're putting them as a beacon transmitter, like on a balloon, or up in satellite stuff. People are finding new uses and new ways to use existing technology that makes it more popular, and each one leads to something else.
Okay, so I'm gonna broach my current pet theory for increasing young participation in ham radio with you, because I'm curious where you're going to respond to this. I've done a couple of shows, one whole show on it, and one I've mentioned it a few times. The label I put on it is radio games, and it is at the very most simple level, it is just relabeling contesting. Because contesting doesn't mean anything to, well, the audience that I'm thinking about aiming toward is young people who do video gaming. Mm-hmm. So the radio games comes from video games. These people are technologically literate generally and interested, but have no clue and no concept of ham radio. Is there something we can do in ham radio that makes a gaming aspect out of ham radio, or adds a ham radio element to something that's going on in the gaming community? Now, we never get everybody, but we're not looking for everybody. We're looking for the slice of people that would be interested if they only had knowledge and the connection. So CQ does a lot of contest sponsorship. I don't know how this would work, but I've seen an example of one game, and speaking of APRS, where it might be cool. There's a game called Ingress. I don't know if you're familiar with it.
No.
It's actually a game that makes you get up off of your couch or computer desk and go out into the real world.
Welcome, agents. I've been waiting for you. So you've heard about Ingress, and you want to know how you play.
But play you're Ingress. Using it with an application on your phone,
so you think
and you go someplace, and by physical proximity, then you can push some buttons on your phone and either capture this thing or develop something, a building, a monument, a statue, and with you and your group, you have to physically get there, and the closer you get, the more power you get over it, and if somebody else owns it, you can capture it and take it away. And then they come back and try to recapture it. It goes back and forth. And you know, the way video games work, different power levels, different abilities, all that sort of stuff.
Sounds like a video game enhancement of fox hunting.
It is something like that. And what I'm thinking of is you show up at this place, and instead of punching a button on your phone, you send an APRS message. and you get something nobody else can get because you did that. Now, instantly, of course, everybody in the gaming community is not a ham says, no fair, I can't do that. Find a ham. Yeah, it's our connection.
It's an interesting topic that you bring up because it's something that I've thought about in slightly different terms at least 15 years ago when I was the earliest days of interactive computer gaming was why do we have to have these games connect to each other over the internet? Why can't they connect to each other over the radio? Put them up on our microwave bands that are lightly used. Use Wi-Fi channels that are shared with ham bands where you can go to higher power, use directional antennas, and create gaming networks.
Yeah, and there's
on the ham bands.
Sort of starting to be developed with the mesh systems and the high-speed microwave networks, but they're still very nascent right now.
And I think there's a potential for that.
Yeah,
for that
and
kind of thing.
And this is at the zero development. Everybody who's saying, no, this is at the zero development level. So shut up.
But
make it work.
Is there potential for doing that? Yeah. And, you know, if it involves then building antennas, building networks, figuring out how to connect your video game to a transceiver to get everything to communicate back and forth, well, does it matter if what you're transmitting and receiving are messages relating to your game as opposed to the weather report and your latest ailments of the week? No, it's what doing stuff, creating things, building things is what ham radio is about.
Yeah, and maybe the guy who's doing that is 25 and not 55.
Yeah.
So,
there
anyway.
Are younger people out there getting interested in ham radio. You see it at Maker Faires. You see it on Facebook. You know, our Facebook audience is on average 10 years younger than our readers. The younger hams are out there. And we in the traditional community have not done what we need to do to attract them and engage them. And part of it is bringing them to what we're doing. The other part is changing what we do to meet their interests.
Yeah, both. We have things they would be interested in if they knew about it, but we need to have more stuff. And once again, we probably can't invent this stuff, you and me.
It's up to the creativity of the hams.
But the first thing I'm afraid of is somebody's going to take this idea and invent a really simple, lame game and say, here's your radio game. And no one's going to like it. But that is the way things start. So I don't know. I see some potential there. But I'm still probably not the guy to even think it up, much less develop it. Certainly not the guy to develop it. But I see a column in CQ sometime about that. All right, I'm out of gas here. How about you?
I thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain what's been happening and where we're looking to go down the road.
I hope there is a long down the road.
Thank you.
And if things really turn around, popular communications started, what, it was like?
1982.
Okay, so CQVHF started,
96.
Went out, and restarted again.
Right.
You'll start up more stuff if there's ability to do it.
Once we can, absolutely. There's a market out there for additional stuff. We talk about it all the time. We would love to find an economically viable model for a really good technical magazine that would be able to.
I just met the editor of Ham Radio magazine outside yesterday.
Huh.
He's here at in Orlando.
You know, Ham Radio was that technical magazine back in the 1970s and 80s.
Yeah.
But that market changed. There was, in the late 80s and early 90s, the interest in technical stuff within the hobby dropped off considerably. It's come back up. And there's a lot of good stuff out there, a lot of interest out there, and a lot of good projects, good stories to be told, good ideas to share, and we would love to be able to have the resources to be a forum for that. Unfortunately, there's a limit to what we can do within the pages of CQ, because good technical articles tend to run long because they've got lots of diagrams and pictures and this and that and, you know, how to do this, and they've, so we can do a discussion.
Well, the internet is perfect for the detail, mm-hmm. and the magazine
and
is perfect
we've done that
for the introduction.
We've done that in some cases where we've done an introductory article in the magazine and then put details on our website of you know, detailed schematics and diagrams and stuff like that, and we'll continue to do that.
That probably doesn't even have to be on your website. It could be on the author's website. We're all
true.
getting these skills.
But there is definitely a potential out there for a whole magazine devoted to that sort of stuff. In CQ, it has to go into the mix.
There is QEX. Let's acknowledge that they exist.
I will acknowledge that they exist. If I was running that magazine, I would be doing it differently.
Uh-oh, Larry, watch out.
That's all. No, there's nothing bad about what they do. I would just see a different approach. They do what they do. They do what they do fine.
This is great.
But they're only bi-monthly with a very limited number of pages. So they're facing the same constraints that we are.
Yeah.
It's a 38-page magazine or something like that every other month. There's a limit to what you can put in there.
Yep.
And there is a market for more. I wish we were in the position to have the resources to do something with that, and I hope that in the not-too-distant future, we will be. And it wouldn't be competing with QEX. It would be a supplemental outlet for people with good ideas for technical articles. Just as I don't think the CQ competes with QST. QST serves a very specific function as the membership journal of the ARRL, and its role is to serve its members. And our role is different. Our role is to be a hobby radio magazine and to touch on all aspects of the ham radio hobby, and starting with March, the broader radio hobby.
Yeah. Well, if you do a Venn diagram of CQ and QST, there's overlap, but
there's definitely overlap, but the basic goals and purposes of the magazines are different enough that I don't see us as being competitors in terms of content. I think, you know, we were joking about the league before, but I think every ham should be a member of the league. The league provides representation that no one else can, and it protects our interests. I'm a life member, have been for most of my life. I used to be a section manager. I used to be on the public relations committee, as you well know. The league is a good organization that every ham should be part of. Every ham should also read CQ, of course,
yeah.
Because they're different. And you're going to get different things from CQ than from QST, because their goals are different.
Yeah. And, of course, my favorite medium, should it ever occur within CQ, and you'd be able to do it, a television show.
That would be fun, too.
You're an old television guy.
Yep.
Look how easy it is now. All right.
The only thing we haven't figured out on that is how to squeeze more than 24 hours into a day.
Yeah. Well, you got to hire a producer. Yeah, I thought for the longest time, and maybe for a short time, that ARL should hire me to do a television show for them. Now I'm so glad that never came to pass, because I realize my editorial discretion would be so prescribed. I wouldn't get to do what I want. I might have made a salary, not a big one, but wouldn't have been able to move to Newington. It would have been interesting, but I also like doing what I want to do and not what somebody else wants me to do. For example, QSTV would not be doing this interview with you today. So CQTV probably wouldn't go down to the ARL booth and talk to them either. But you never know.
You never know.
You never know.
You never know.
Call me. This has been long enough for a full episode. It didn't start out to be a full episode, but since it's been long enough, we get to finish this off. So, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, right into that
queue. I'm Rich Moseson, W2VU, editor of CQ.
73 everybody over.
And 70 years, folks, out.